I'm here to talk to you about God's principle as it concerns financial blessings. Therefore, if you're interested in making more money, if you're interested in money, if you're interested in having more, managing money better, looking at what the Bible really says concerning finances and money, then I say, do not change this. Keep watching, because your blessings is about to happen just now. Hello, welcome to my channel. Welcome to Straight Out of Scriptures, where we tell biblical truths, give scriptural perspective to today's issue, to this matter. And I'm excited about today. Why? Because today the question before us is very simple, Jermaine, and it's important. The person asked, why is it that I preach so much, yet I do not have financial reward? I do not have financial harvest. I'm not living in abundance. I don't even have much. I don't have money. And yet I pray in tongues. I pray in the spirit. I pray at all times. I mean, that's an important issue. Right, if this is your first time on this channel, don't forget to subscribe. I want you to just generally engage with this channel, like, comment, share, tell a friend about it. Why is it that I do not have much? Why is it that I pray so much and yet it is not yielding financially for me? Allow me to say to you that there are certain things in life that do not work simply by praying. You have to pray and then you have to do something else in it with it. I'll give you a very valid and vivid example to press in at this point. All right, somebody said to me, and the person said, I'm looking for a child. I want to have a child, and he's been praying. Maybe the woman has been praying, oh God, give me a child, give me a baby. All right, if herself and her husband don't come together, they don't have sex together, there's no way they're going to have a child. It's not about prayers, because that prayer will only work upon the seed that is sown. So it's the same way it works here. It's not only prayers that will get you certain financial things. They will happen only by the instrumentality of doing certain things, following God's principles as it concerns that. So today I'm excited. I want to teach you on biblical financial principles, because I think this is the answer. I believe sincerely that this is the answer to what this person is really asking. All right, I want to start by saying that as believers, we know many things. I feel that one of the things we do not know about is finances. We do not know as much as we should on what the Bible says about money, what the Bible says about finances, what the Bible says about wealth. And it's essential. It's important. Am I a prosperity teacher? No, I'm just a teacher of the Word of God. And it's there in scriptures. Abraham was wealthy. The patriarchs were wealthy. They were in poor people. And they were not wealthy because there was a window open in the heavens and people were just throwing down cows and all of that. They were wealthy because of certain things they did, certain investment they had, certain management principles. You find it all through the pages of scriptures. From Genesis to Revelation, you find these principles there. So, Bible says, my people are in captivity for lack of knowledge. Knowledge is therefore the principal of things. Wisdom is principal thing. You know, you're getting, get understanding. I think it is time for us. I think that's Proverbs 4 and verse 6. It's time for us as believers to get to the understanding of how finances work as it concerns God. What is God's plan for our finances? What is God's principle as it concerns overflow? And today I want to share certain principles with you. I want to make it quite short. I believe we should finish today, but if we don't, then we'll continue again. But it's important. Important you understand these principles, because if you understand these principles, you'll be able to say bye-bye to poverty. You'll be able to say bye-bye to certain things. And you will see that as you pray and walk these principles, I'm not saying walk these principles without prayers, but as you pray and walk these principles, these God's financial principles, these biblical financial principles, as you begin to walk them, then you begin to see results in your life, and you'll be asking yourself, what have I been doing all this while? All right, let me start by telling you first principle. I want to share 9 principles with you, and I believe these 9 principles are biblical financial principles. I give you scriptures for it. I'll tell you how it applies to you, what you should do about them, and all of that. Number one, first principle is that God is the owner of everything. Can I say that to someone again? That God owns everything. God owns everything. You need to understand that. You need to believe that God is the owner of everything. The Bible says, in the beginning, God created. Genesis chapter 1 verse 1. It means that in the beginning God created everything. It means that there was nothing there before God created them. Therefore, God owns everything. Bible says in Haggai chapter 2 verse 8, silver is mine, gold is mine, declares the Lord. 50:10 of Psalms, Bible says every animal upon the thousand hills, they are the Lord's. So God is the owner of all things. Bible says the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. Psalms 37 verse 21. It is therefore flowing out from this logic that you understand that there is nothing a man has that is not from God. John, in fact, said it in John chapter 3. He said, no man can receive anything except it be given from the Lord. So God is the giver of all things. God owns all things. Therefore, if there is anything you have, you are just trustees. You are managers of what God has given. Bible says, everyone who is put in charge, 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1, the Bible says, is therefore required in stewardship that a man be found faithful. Faithfulness is a quality. It wasn't talking about finances, but it's a general principle that works. Faithfulness to what God has given you. You are just a steward, someone who is put in charge of something that is owned by another. So no matter how much money enters into your account, no matter the money you receive on a weekly or on a daily basis, you can't just spend it the way you like it. Understand that that money is not yours. You are a steward of God's resource. That means God is channeling his resources through you. We must look at the heart like God's big restaurant. All right, so God has put us there as servants. All right, that's what a steward does. So we are stewards. We manage on behalf of God so that the restaurant of God keep working. We keep doing that. All right, use resources that God has given you. You will use it wisely. That's why this principle is important. If you understand that it is not mine, then whatever resource that God gives to you, whatever it is that you have, then the first thing you understand is that this is not mine. This is God. So if God is giving me, then I must use it well because I am also accountable to God. And that's very key. Understand that. And that also means that word faithfulness is very key. It means trustworthiness. It matters in the kingdom. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? Luke 16:10 to 12, Jesus was speaking. So the first principle is that God owes everything. I tell people that in your head, in your mind, everywhere, first of all, just believe that everything you have, your cars, your wristwatches, everything you have, everything that matters to you, your children, everything you possess, financial, material, whatever it is God's. Therefore, however you use it, it's going to be determined by who owns it, because the manager determines who gets served with what and determines who keeps working. Will get promoted to positions of supervisors and higher positions. Why? Because of faithfulness and being found reliable and trustworthy. The first question I want to ask you, man of God, woman of God, child of God, this day is God finding you trustworthy? Can God say, yes, that's my reliable servant? Can God say, yes, that's somebody who I find very trustworthy? Number two principle here, it's what you must call the blessedness of work. It's the principle of God. And because it is from the work of your hands, Bible says that the Lord will bless the work of your hands. I've seen people pray, and then I ask them a simple question. What are you doing? And then they say, I'm not doing anything. Listen, even if you are looking for a job, get a skill. If you are not profitably employed in a blue collar job, or whether they call it white collar, blue collar job or something, get something you are doing, because that is what God will bless. You can pray all night, pray all day. Listen, God will still have to bless you. That's what your prayer is about. But the blessing is going to come upon the work of your hands. Therefore, understand the blessedness of work. It is where our earnings come from, a blessedness of work. You see, many believers think that work is a curse. But I've had people say, if not for Adam and Eve, now we would have been in the garden just eating fruit. We would not have been working. But that's not true. That's not so. Genesis chapter 2 verse 15, the Bible says, then the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden of Eden to tend and keep it. human beings were given work before anything else. That's the account of scriptures. Work to do. Work is therefore not because a resultant effect of the sin of man, because that happened before the curse. So the work you're doing is not a curse. It's called the blessedness of work. Work precedes sin. Work is God's way of creation. God is work, God's way of creation. God, work is the language of creation. And work is also how God has channeled the work to the word to operate. It is via the instrumentality of work that we can maintain creativity, that we can maintain creation. You need to understand that any field that is left to its own will not be fine. You have to tend and keep it. You have to tend and keep it. You have to tend and keep it. You need to also understand that work is given so that you can tend and keep yourself. God has invited us to join Him in the ongoing art of caring for creation. That's number one. He has also called us to continue the work of creation in His stead. And work is the only way you and I can continue the work of creation. I mean, that's what the theology of work teaches. We must understand this principle, that work is not a curse. I see people go to work and say, my work is bad, my work is dead. But work is not a curse. It's the way we continue in the likeness of God, the creative work of God. And we must understand that principle. Be diligent, that will affect our attitude towards work. You see, when you understand that work is not a curse, work is a blessing, work is what we are called to do, work is us creating in the likeness of God, then we do things with another style, we do things with a new level of understanding, we do things with a new level of grace. Why? Because we are now working in knowledge and understanding. This is what the Bible teaches. This is the principle of God. It affects you, you become diligent. Whatever you do, work with all your heart as working for the Lord. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 23. And it is via work that you provide for ourselves and those who are dependent on us. Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 8. Bible says those who don't care for their own and those of their own households, they say they are worse than unbelievers. They are worse than infidels. That's what scripture says. You see, it is via work that you can provide for your own need. Somebody say, I don't have money. I don't have anything. Instead of you begging, why not get a work? Instead of you begging, ask yourself, what skill do I have? Will I just set the foundation of my life right? Will I go and learn IT? Will I go get a skill? Will I go understand how the world of fintech, the world of technology? Will I go and learn videography, editing, and all of these soft skills? Will I go and learn a soft skill? Why? Because it is needed. If you are going to get into more financial harvest, then the work of your hands must be blessed. It's a biblical principle. It is simple. Many believers are in poverty because there is nothing that God is going to bless. Enjoy your work. That's another attitude. You enjoy your work when you understand I am contributing to the work of creation. I am contributing to the world of creativity. I am serving my gift to a generation. Many people are working in banks, working in finance, working in insurance and all those things. You really cannot see what they do. It's called a service business. You see, you are serving your skill, you are serving your time, you are serving your ability and your gift in order to make the world a better place. You must understand that. And that's a principle of God. It's called the blessedness of work. It is via this that resources come. People are paid for their work. People get money for their work. It is the way the world operates. It is the way God has made the world to operate. You can say, listen, my man of God, he doesn't do much. No, he labors in the world and in prayer. That is the demand of the disciples. They said, listen, we will not serve tables. We will labor in the word of God and in prayers. And because they pray and they do these things, the Bible also says that the ox should not be muscled. Therefore, the resources comes to them. I'm saying in their own work, they are diligent. I know that your mentor is your pastor, but are you also diligent in your own work, in your own field, in your own vocation? If your pastor spent 12 hours reading the word of God, praying, don't you think if you spend half of that time reading, learning about your vocation, about how you can be better, don't you think you have much more money? Don't you think you will enter into much more resources? Number three, third principle from scriptures is giving. Giving is not just what the pastors like to talk about. Giving is God's set way of meeting needs of people. Giving is God's set way of meeting the needs of people.
Therefore, when somebody is used to be a blessing to you, to give you certain things, that person is operating in a channel. It's a mystery. It's the channel God has created in ensuring that things get to you, and through you also, things get to others. It's a means. Giving is one of God's primary way of meeting needs. When you give, you supply the need of others. And when others also give, they also supply your own need also. So you must understand, the generous giver, one who gives with an obedient will, a joyful attitude, and a compassionate heart, is called a generous giver. We are made to give. Why? Because God is a giver. Bible says God gave his only son. God gives. And we are made, Genesis chapter 1, 26, 27, in the image and in the likeness of God. Giving is the way we respond to God's goodness. Giving is the way we focus on God, who is our source. Giving is the way we bless others. I think I've harped on this. Bible says in Genesis chapter 12, 2 to 3, see, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you'll be a blessing. I will bless you and make your name great, and so you shall be a blessing. Paul said in 1 Timothy 6, 18, command them who are rich to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. Bible says in Luke chapter 6, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men give unto you. So when you give, your giving is also like a seed. So when you give, you are sowing seed. And Bible says, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men also give to us. When you give, it is important. Scripture says we should give expectantly. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, 6 to 7. The one who plants generously will get a generous crop. You must each make up your own mind as to how much you should give. Don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves those who give cheerfully. God loves those who give cheerfully. It's important you give. Fourth principle, biblical principles that will help you change your life. Apart from the fact that you must release ownership to God, apart from the fact that you must be a giver, apart from the fact that you must understand the blessedness of work, is that you must be a wise saver. Saving is like you building. It's like you preserving. It's like you invest. You must save. Saving is important. Anyone who does not save is not a wise person. He's not following God's biblical standard. The way of scriptures is to save. Saving is the way of the wise. I don't know how much you earn. No matter how small it is, you can save a percentage of it. I was teaching them in class one day and I said to them, listen, set aside 10%. I know you give 10% as tithe, which is important. Give also another 10% as saving, the minimal you should do. 10% as saving. You'll be amazed and surprised as how much it will become. I tell people, if you really want to get into so much money, then you must save for the rainy days, like people will say, but you must also save for investment. So to between 10 to 30%, no matter who you are, you must save of what your income is, of what your income is. That's how to get into money. It's not just about prayer. You must save. The Bible says in Proverbs 21:20, in the house of the wise are stores of choice food and oil, but the foolish devour it all. In the house of the wise are stores. So this is also savings. Savings is store. People save food in their store. They tell you, I have food in my storehouse, in the store in my house. You must also have some money in your savings account. You must have money in savings. I don't know how or where you save it, but you must have money there. Bible says, go to the ants, use longer, consider his ways and be wise. It has no commander, no overseer or ruler, yet he stores his provision in summer and gathers his food at harvest. He saves. You must learn to be a saver. You must save. You must prioritize. Out of all your income, you can't afford to spend it all. Don't do that. That's the reason many people enter into debt, because a need will come suddenly and they don't have what is needed to meet that need, and they go and take loan. They go into debt. They go and borrow money. Why? Because they are not saving. You must learn to be like the ant. Save. And then number five principle here, invest. you must learn to invest wisely. If you don't invest, you will not have much. Can I say that to someone again? If you do not invest, you will not have much. Many people only receive money from their salary, just one income. Investment is the way in which you put your money in plenty baskets. You put your money in plenty baskets. It's called diversifying your options. Give portions to seven, yes to eight, for you do not know what disaster will come upon the land. It's important you have options. You put your egg not only in one basket but diversify. It's called diversification. You must learn to do that. And when you do that, you must invest wisely. Make your options. Choose your option wisely. The Bible says, seek wise counselors. Don't just make the decision. I was talking to a chap yesterday and he was telling me how he lost so much money. And the gist was that he was investing and putting money inside in a thing he does not have so much information about. Therefore, seek wise counsel. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 5, let the wise listen and add to their learning, and let the discerning gain guidance. You must listen to people who are experts. Don't go and start a business because you had a testimony. Don't go and start a business because somebody said something on YouTube. Many times when those experts speak, they don't give you all the details. You must go and ask questions. You must seek. And don't just think this is good and go and do it. Another thing people do and lose money and then they blame God and say God is not with them is they listen to others who tell them about get quick rich scheme. There are get rich quick schemes. Bible says we should run from it. Proverbs 28 verse 20 says the trustworthy will get a rich reward, but the person who wants to get rich quick will only get into trouble. A person who wants to get quick rich will only get into trouble. That's why many people are in financial mess. I remember the days of MMM in my nation, Nigeria, MMM. And before after the lockdown, there was a lot of people investing in 30%, 60% return and all of that. Many of those things were scammers. And eventually, it didn't work and many people lost their life savings. You must understand that when we say invest, invest wisely. Diversify your portfolio. I was telling Zion folks, I was telling them about the man called Solomon and David. Bible says, how did they get into their increase? Apart from the fact that these guys had flocks, they had cattle. At that time where they also came in and where they lived in, they had armies that just go. And the Bible says the bandits will go and they will take a spoil and then they will come back. That is increasing what they have. How? Through weapon of war. So that is allowed, agreeable at the time when they lived in. The Bible also talked about Solomon. Solomon had a sheep. He had merchants. And Bible says, trust concerning Solomon again, that he went to Egypt to buy horses and he traded them off with higher prices. Was that he was trading. He was a merchant. He was buying and selling. So it was not just one thing that he did that made him so rich. It wasn't just his wisdom that made him so rich and made silver useless in Jerusalem because it was a time of great riches. It was because he was into many businesses. You must tell yourself, I know you are a videographer. I understand you are an IT specialist, but why not invest in mortgage? Why not invest in land? Why not invest in some of other things? Diversify your income so that when anything happens to that your field, you are stabilized in another field. And that is very important. Number six principle I found in God's word, avoid debt. Many people live in a creditor's world. Your life goes on based on your credit rating. I mean, that's what happens if you are in America, if you are in Europe, and most of these developed countries. If you are going to make sense out of your life, not just pray, you must avoid taking debt. Now, I need to explain to you what debt is biblically. Biblically, debt is not you just borrowing money. Biblically, debt is a failure to fulfill a contractual obligation. That's what debt is. Therefore, if you take, for instance, $100,000, $10,000, 100 million naira from someone, this is October, and you say to the person, I'm going to pay you back in December, they are going to say you have a contract with that person. You are not really a debtor. But the moment December comes and January comes and you have not been able to fulfill that contractual obligation, then you become a debtor. Do you understand that? So debt is fulfilling contractual, is the lack of fulfillment of contractual obligation. Therefore, people take loan. For instance, in Nigeria, the central bank was saying that the debtors list should be published by banks all over the nation. Now, it was not the names of the people published, were not the names of everybody who took a loan from the bank. No, that they are not debtors because they had a contractual obligation. The names published were the names of people who are not able to fulfill that obligation. Do you understand that? So basically, you need to get it right. Many people enter into debt because they are not careful, they are not wise, and you should repay your debt promptly. That's what scripture says. You take a mortgage loan, you take a car loan, you take a land loan, whatever it is you take, first of all, ask yourself, am I ready to pay back? Bible says in Psalms 37:21, the wicked borrow and do not repay, but the righteous give generously. Generously. I think these are very important reasons for people to actually avoid the bondage of debts. The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender. Proverbs 22 verse 7. Debt presumes on the future. Now listen, you will say today or tomorrow we will go to this city, to that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why? You do not even know what will happen tomorrow or what is your life. Repay your debt as that time is due. Because you see, many people enter into debt and they cannot pay back. And because of this debt, they cannot even plan their finances. So according to God's method, therefore, the idea is to pay back your debt as fast as you can, so that you can plan going forward financially. And that is God's demand upon each and every one of us. That's God's demand upon our life. God demands that you and I do not live in debt, so that we can live in the abundance of His blessings. If you have a loan, therefore, try and pay it back. Be quick in paying back. Debt can also deny God the opportunity to work in our lives and teach us valuable lessons. Don't be greedy for what you don't have. Real life is not measured by what a man owns. Jesus said that in Luke chapter 12 verse 16. A man does not consist of the abundance of things he possesses. Learn to live by your means. These are things that causes problem. Biblical financial principles. Follow these principles and your life will work better. Follow these principles and you will discover that if you pray with these principles, things will work better for you. But when we don't pray with these principles, when we don't do these principles, we begin to ask ourselves, why are things not working in our life? I believe I'm going to stop here this week. And I believe that next week I'm going to be sharing with you, going further with certain principles. I'm still here to talk about how you are supposed to manage your money, how you are supposed to share these things. I'm here to talk to you about faith. Therefore, next week, don't miss that episode for anything. I'm going to be sharing with you on the concept of faith for finances, because it's very important. And I'm going to also look at Solomon. We're going to look at Solomon and see how Solomon's wealth came, the principles we can learn from his life. And I'm sure it's going to bless your life. So subscribe to this channel. I'll be back next week. And if you really want to understand about prayers and listening to God as it concerns things, I suggest listening to the podcast last week, and it's going to bless you. Take care of yourself, and the Lord keep you. Bye.